Assalamu alaikum students. So today we'll be discussing the various forms of carbon dioxide carriage in blood, and then we'll talk about that when carbon dioxide is, and when it's taken to the lungs, how is it dissociated, and again the drama that I mentioned in oxygen dissociation in tissues, there's a little drama going on in carbon dioxide dissociation in the lungs as well. So we'll talk about that. That is called Haldane's effect. Number one is a total amount of 4 ml in every deciliter of carbon dioxide is carried from tissues to the lungs. So that needs to be remembered. Secondly, venous partial pressure of carbon dioxide is 45 because it's loaded with carbon dioxide from the tissues. And when it has unloaded that, a segment of that, the arterial PCO2 comes down to 40. Okay. In summary, we'll discuss the whole thing in detail in a bit. In summary, carbon dioxide is transported in three forms. One is dissolved carbon dioxide as gas, that's the least 7%. Carbon dioxide with hemoglobin as carboxyhemoglobin is 23%. And then as bicarbonate ion, it's the most abundant form of carbon dioxide transport to 70%. Okay, so now what happens? We'll start off with tissues. So obviously carbon dioxide is being made in as a result of metabolism, so we need to talk about tissues, the cells that are actually producing carbon dioxide, and by the way they are the ones who are using oxygen obviously. So when the red blood cell brings in oxygen, oxygen goes in, hemoglobin is now made available. So when the carbon dioxide comes through, which is by the way a very has a very high solubility index, it comes through very fluently, first gets dissolved in plasma, then gets dissolved in the water inside the RBCs, and then in addition to this, carbon dioxide combines with hemoglobin, as I just mentioned, to make HBCO2. In this, the hemoglobin is being contributed because the oxygen is now disconnected and now carbon dioxide can bind with it. As we know, carbon dioxide is being formed in the cells. So when the blood passes through and route to the heart, the oxygen has been displaced from the hemoglobin within the RBCs. Now carbon dioxide, when it diffuses towards or inside the blood, the first stop is plasma where it gets dissolved. In addition, of course it's all seamless because carbon dioxide has a very high solubility index. It also gets into RBCs pretty quickly and gets dissolved in the water inside the RBCs. A point here, a quantitative point is, when all this dissolution of carbon dioxide within this plasma and the water part of the RBCs is done, the total amount in quantity of dissolved carbon dioxide in venous blood is 2.7 ml per deciliter, okay, at a pressure of 45 mmHg. Okay. Now we know the 45 mmHg, but what we need to note is the 2.7 milligram per deciliter. That's the physical amount of carbon dioxide that venous blood is carrying for every deciliter of blood, right? On the contrary, when it gives away its carbon dioxide in the lungs and when it becomes arterial blood, which is oxygenated, the carbon dioxide partial pressure drops from 45 to 40. And the volume percent, the actual volume of carbon dioxide from 2.7, it drops to 2.4. So the total difference in carbon dioxide amount, the dissolved bit, is only 0.3. Okay, this is something that that needs to be noted, that the dissolved part is a very small part which is exchanged actually on a routine basis. Now, The second form is in combination with hemoglobin to form carboxyhemoglobin, and hemoglobin here needs to be in context that this is the hemoglobin that now has been released from oxygen because we have given the oxygen away and now it can combine with carbon dioxide. And then the most, coming to the point of the most abundant way of carbon dioxide carriage, is the way it's carried in hydrogen and bicarbonate form. How does this come about? Well, carbon dioxide reacts with the abundant water inside the RBC. Now, in the absence of carbonic anhydrase, an enzyme which is abundant inside the RBCs, if this enzyme were not abundant in the RBCs, then this reaction would not have been mentioned so much, because the speed of carbon dioxide and water to form carbonic acid without an enzymatic addition is very, very, very poor. Okay, it really is the spectacular rate at which carbonic anhydrase can act, and not just act, its amount of the enzyme present in the RBCs is of course of significant quantity. This enzymatic reaction becomes very, very quick. In fact, it increases the rate of this reaction 5,000 folds. Okay, so as soon as carbon dioxide is sniffed by the RBC, it immediately connects with water, and it doesn't have any hold of this. It's so fast that it becomes carbonic acid, not shown here, and then carbonic acid then dissociates into hydrogen ions and bicarbonate. Now, hydrogen ion is again can be combined with hemoglobin, because hemoglobin has buffering qualities as well, as you must have read in your blood physiology. So hemoglobin binds with hydrogen to form HBH with hydrogen ion, and the bicarbonate that is formed is of course all of this is being formed at a very high concentration because of the explosive combination of a lot of carbon dioxide and a lot of water. So rate of hydrogen and bicarb is of course at a high rate. So lots of bicarbonate ions, when they are formed, they start to go out. Now this protein, this antiport mechanism, this transport protein, is also called band 3 protein, because when it's measured, it forms a very characteristic 3 bands on electrophoresis. Anyway, so bicarbonate, when it goes out, it has to be balanced, of course. Chloride moves in. So this is bicarbonate, one out, one chloride in. Whatever number of bicarbonate come out, equal number of chloride move in the RBCs. So the content of chloride of the RBCs in venous blood is more than the arterial blood. Now we'll talk about when this systemic circulation becomes pulmonary circulation, and now this blood has gone to the lungs. In the lungs, the mirror reverse happens, and the speed of whatever reactions and whatever dissolutions were going on in the tissue, they become opposite, and they the whole thing is literally a mirror, and carbon dioxide is given out. However, there's a little detail here. What is that detail? You see how oxygen is coming in and combining with hemoglobin. Okay, so this hemoglobin was originally binding with not just carbon dioxide, as we saw here, but also with hydrogen, as we saw here. So HB partially is combined with carbon dioxide and partially is combined with hydrogen. And this is the subject matter of the next slide, the Haldane effect. This actually is the Haldane effect, that at high PO2s, the effect of removal of carbon dioxide from hemoglobin is facilitated, as compared to if you have low PO2. So you can understand it by imagining that a high PO2 works like a force which evicts the carbon dioxide from the hemoglobin and sits in its place. It replaces carbon dioxide. This is called a Haldane effect, and it makes carbon dioxide carriage by blood more efficient. We'll talk about that in a bit. So this is that oxygen coming in, and then everything is reversed. So carbon dioxide, hemoglobin, when it's removed, carbon dioxide becomes a gas which can be given out. The hydrogen, which has been released now from the hemoglobin, forms the one of the main characters in the formation of carbonic acid, but now in the reverse direction. So the bicarbonate also comes back, chloride goes out, available bicarbonate reacts with hydrogen in the presence of carbonic anhydrase to form carbonic acid H2CO3, which then changes into water and carbon dioxide gaseous form. The carbon dioxide gas again follows the same pathway, and it goes out, and you exhale it. This is the overall carriage of carbon dioxide in blood. Okay, now let's see what happens in the so-called Haldane effect. Haldane effect, basically, in summary, is quantitatively much more important for carbon dioxide carriage than Bohr is for oxygen carriage. Okay, so Haldane effect enhances the release of carbon dioxide in the lungs when deoxygenated blood is visiting it. Without it, quantitatively speaking, only half of carbon dioxide would be able to release from the blood. Again, lots of drama over there. It's the dissociation where the drama is, one of the ways to remember it. First, I will just give you the nutshell so you can remember, and then we'll go into the nitty-gritties. You need to think about four volume percents, okay? Four volume percents of carbon dioxide. These are the four units, or four volume percents, or 4 ml per deciliter that the blood picks up from the tissues and is now going to the lungs, and it has reached the lungs. These 4 volume percents need to be offloaded in the lungs and exhaled as gas carbon dioxide. Okay. However, without Haldane effect, okay, only 2 volume percent would be able to be exhaled. Now, let's look at this graph. This graph is a simple carbon dioxide hemoglobin dissociation curve. Okay, it's simple in the sense that it only gives you the PCO2 along the x-axis and carbon dioxide in volume percents on the y-axis. Okay, the thing to remember here are the two PCO2s. When the blood has picked up carbon dioxide, the PCO2 goes up to 45, which is right around here. Okay, and which corresponds to a volume percent of 52. So 52 volume percents is what, in volume percent terms, is what deoxygenated blood is carrying in terms of carbon dioxide. And when carbon dioxide is offloaded, the PCO2 drops to from 45 to 40, and this corresponds to 48, around 48 volume percents. This is what normally goes on. How does it go on like that? Okay, as I mentioned, that between 52 and 48, you have 4 volume percents. Haldane explains how it's 4. If without Haldane, it should be 2. Now, let's come to this diagram. This is the Haldane effect. Okay. They have shown you two curves. Okay. One is a bold curve, which actually happens normally. And the other is a dotted curve, which is a hypothetical curve. So, these curves are drawn against specific PO2s. So the red curve has been drawn, it is a carbon dioxide dissociation curve, carbon dioxide hemoglobin dissociation curve, but the bold one has been drawn when the blood was exposed to a PO2 of 100 mmHg, as opposed to the dotted one. The dotted one, in this particular blood was exposed to a PO2 of only 40 mmHg, just to see the effect of oxygen. Remember the previous slide I showed you, when the oxygen binds to the hemoglobin, it dissociates the carbon dioxide, and I mentioned the Haldane effect over there. This is its graphical and quantitative form, right? So with both of these graphs in place, this graph is drawn, let's imagine, in the lungs. So the blood has come back loaded and stuff with carbon dioxide, and now let's see what happens. Blood would be at a PCO2 of 45 and volume percent would be 52. This is where it will intersect, point number A. If the PO2 is 40, okay, then only 2 volume percent can be removed, as I just mentioned. So what happens if you draw this, if you look at the dotted curve and you see where does it come across 40 mmHg PCO2, because that is what happens when you bring the carbon dioxide out. It intersects at a point which corresponds to 50 volume percents. So only 2 have been able to be removed. Okay. However, when you look at the bold curve, which is drawn with PO2 of 100 mmHg, so in the alveoli you have normal PO2, which is around 100, then it would drop from point A to point B. Okay, because now when you look at the bold curve, 40 PCO2 of 40 is intersecting it at point number B. Point number B on the y-axis corresponds to 48 volume percent. Basically, we have enlarged this component here of the carbon dioxide hemoglobin dissociation curve and showed it to you over here. So from 52, it drops to 48 volume percent in the presence of high oxygen, around 400 mmHg. which it would not have been able to do if the PO2 would have been 40 mmHg. In that case, it would have only had lost 2 volume percent. So Haldane effect quantitatively enhances the offloading of carbon dioxide, which is much needed in the normal acid-base physiology, respiratory physiology of the lung.